All I wanted was to inspect this COMPAQ Portable 2.
Only to find this floppy drive being broken.
And furtherly to find the CMOS battery being dead. And finally to find the dead hard drive as well.
The only question is, can I fix it?
Retro computing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories.
So here I am unboxing the Portable 2. While this may not be too overly interesting, I want to show it anyway, as this is a perfect example of how to pack up a sensitive device like this for shipping. Lots of styrofoam, lots of paper or plastic wrap, and, ideally, a box in box for additional dampening. I will feature a negative example of such in another follow-up video. You see, the Portable 2 is a lockable-sized PC. Of course, given the age, it was not totally unexpected to find the CMOS battery being dead. What surprised me though was the broken floppy drive. It would totally refuse to read my boot floppy disk, as we can see here. To remove the case, you have to remove the four screws, which sit behind the two plastic shift panels. Once removed, you can gently pull up the cover. By removing this cover, I can gain access to the expansion bus slots. In addition to that, I also removed the top cover of the drive cage, so I can remove it later on. But first, I have to pull out the expansion boards, one being the graphics card and the other being the I/O controller. Next is to free the floppy drive from the drive cage. I suspected this already, but here we have the proof. Pay close attention to the center of the magnetic spindle. Can you see how uneven it runs? Let's do some close-up inspection. See how the large screw and also the two soldering points just beneath it look dull and somewhat oxidized? This is a sure indication of a blown capacitor that leaked out onto the PCB. I might be able to fix this, but at that point I didn't have the correct capacitors at hand, so I thought to continue by borrowing the floppy drive from the IBM 5150 PC, but we remember.
Only to find out, this one's broken as well.
Well, while I could fix the IBM drive, I eventually received the proper spare capacitors for the COMPAQ floppy drive, which is actually a Canon 5201. So I furtherly dismantled the drive so I could replace the broken capacitors. There's multiple caps on the two PCBs, and I removed all of them. I gave them a quick measurement with the multimeter to see if all were broken. Obviously, only two were defective, but I replaced all of them nevertheless. With this being done, I would eventually reassemble the entire drive to try again if it works. Oh yes, this looks a lot better now. The magnetic heads now move again and also the spindle runs totally even again, so the floppy disk can be read. For the hard drive, I had already noticed that the drive spindle would not start on power up. I configured the drive as a Type 2 drive in the BIOS, but to no avail. It would always end up with a disk zero failure. Well, it is what it is. There is claims that you could revive it if you give it a gentle blow with a rubber hammer. Other people seem to open the drive to re-lubricate them. Well, this is clearly beyond my skills, so I will not lose any time with any such obscure activities. But before I turn back at the hard drive topic, I'll fix the CMOS battery quickly. This one is easy, as it's accessible from the backside behind yet another cover. It's actually a AA-sized cell though I have no matching one currently available. But I will not destroy the cell compartment, but just add some temporary wiring to which I can attach an equivalent voltage cell. Doing it this way will allow me to replace it once I get hold of a correct battery. And now back again to the hard drive. I decided to keep the original hard drive in the drive cage, but not to connect it. Instead, I'm about to install an IDE to compact flash adapter. In this case, I use one that mounts to an expansion slot bracket, where I can slide in the flash card from the outside. So now I can install COMPAQ's OEM version of MS-DOS 3.31. That's a bit too recent, as this machine originally shipped with MS-DOS 3.1 in 1986. This version does not have a setup program, so I have to run through the FDisk procedure for partitioning the drive. This flash card has 32 MB of capacity, but using the BIOS Type 2 setting, it's limited to 20 MB. Accordingly, I remove any pre-existing partition and create a new one that properly aligns with the BIOS capacity. Then I have to manually format the drive C and transfer the system files onto it. Last but not least, I create the DOS directory on drive C and copy the contents of my three floppy disks into it. With the final reboot, the Portable 2 now starts off the hard drive. Used keyboards are always a bit disgusting. On this behalf, I typically remove all keycaps to have them cleaned and also remove some debris from the backside. This time I'm lazy, as I don't want to fully disassemble the entire keyboard, but that's good enough anyway, I can still clean it well enough. Here's a bonus. You probably noticed my impatience to continue, hence me borrowing the IBM floppy drive to get along. In the meantime, I have received yet another 5 1/4 inch floppy drive for exactly such future purposes. And as we can see here, the test was successful. And here's for bonus number 2. For the restoration of my IBM 5150 PC, I organized a second Tandon floppy drive, and since the 5150 does not work yet, I took the chance to test it against the Portable 2 as well. Uh-oh, this noise! This sounds really unhealthy. But after all, it's still able to read the discs as it seems. I guess I'm gonna take the same route as in my last video to re-lubricate the mechanical components. Oh yes, now you can't barely hear the drive anymore. This is so much better and gives me confidence for the next steps with the IBM 5150 PC. Stay tuned for future updates on this topic.
And this concludes my attempt at reviving the COMPAQ Portable 2. As always, if you liked this video, then please give me a thumbs up. See you next time.